Brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. In our first lecture, we mentioned how the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam emphasized on the importance of marriage, simplified marriage, and also spoke about the relationship that should exist between spouses, the relationship that should exist between a husband and his wife and vice versa. We shed light on a verse in Surah Ar-Rum, which mentions that our spouses are in reality part of the signs of God subhanahu wa ta'ala, and mentions how Allah Azza wa Jal instilled mawadda, love and mercy between spouses. This word in itself indicates, we said, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants an atmosphere of respect, love and mercy to exist in the household, and does not want to see one spouse manifesting enmity and or oppressing the other. Ahlul Bayt salamullahi alayhim, they confirm this issue. There are several, in fact many, traditions where Ahlul Bayt salamullahi alayhim mention how a husband is supposed to treat his wife, and how a wife is supposed to treat her husband, and how there should be mutual respect and mutual love between them. For example, when we come to the book Wasa'il al-Shia, we have a short yet deep tradition by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, which says, خَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ. It seems here that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi is talking about who? He's talking to males. He's saying the best amongst you are the ones who treat their wives in the best of manners. So by saying this, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi is teaching the men that if you want to attain higher positions of proximity to Allah, higher positions of perfection in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then treat your wives with care, with respect. Be gentle towards your wives. Oppressing your wives is not part of manhood. See, some men understand that if you're truly a man, then you should treat your wife in any way you want. No, that's not the meaning of manhood. That's not part of manhood. The Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, خَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ. The best amongst you are the ones who treat their wives in the best of manners. Then he says, وَأَنَا خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِي. I am the one who treats his wives in the best of manners. Meaning none of you Muslims exceed me in the good treatment you show towards your wives. As good as your good treatment might be, mine is even better. Indeed, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, Rasulullah's treatment towards his wives was impeccable, which is quite obvious because he was the Prophet, he was the master of mankind, the master of creations, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. But what's interesting is, as some of you might know, some of his wives were angels, yes. In fact, some of his wives were better than angels, like Khadija alayhi salam. Khadija salamullah alayha never hurt Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, not even with a word. Not even with a word. And by doing that, Khadija salamullah alayha presented a beautiful example. She set a great example for our ladies on how they're supposed to treat their husbands. Never did she offend Rasulullah or hurt him with a single word. So some of his wives were what? Were great. But some of his wives were not so great. They were quite disturbing. They would hurt the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And Surah At-Tahrim is quite clear on this issue. Surah At-Tahrim tells us there were two wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam who were plotting against him, who were fighting the Prophet in one way or another. Some of his wives were disturbing, but even then, he tolerated them. He was patient. And by doing that, he set a great example for us on how to deal with what? On how to deal with our wives and how to tolerate our wives. For example, in Bihar al-Anwar, we have a tradition by Aisha, which says, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi would mention Khadija bint Khuwaylid salawatullahi alayha, he would not stop. He would continuously mention the virtues of Khadija. And so one day, as the Prophet was going on and on about Khadija salamullahi alayha, Aisha says, I felt jealousy. I felt jealous from what the Prophet was saying sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. And so she told him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compensated you. He compensated you and gave you someone in exchange of that old lady. Calling Khadija what? An old lady. As if she's saying that, you know, you have younger wives, you can show them attention and forget about Khadija salamullah alayha. Rasulullah was disturbed sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. The tradition says he became really angry to the point Aisha said, she said, Ya Allah, if you get rid of the Prophet's anger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, then I will not mention Khadija in a negative manner after today. Khalas. For the rest of my life, I will never mention Khadija in a negative manner. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi told her. He told her, how did you say this word? I swear by Allah, she believed in me when the people disbelieved in me. She embraced me when the people rejected me. She believed my words when the people neglected my words and called me a liar. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed her by making her the mother of my children, yet none of you were blessed with children of mine. Excluding, of course, who? Maria al-Qibtiyya, radiyallahu anha. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi was really tolerant. And he taught the Muslims that treating your wives in a good way, being tolerant with your wives, is actually part of Islam. On the other hand, he also emphasized on Muslim women to do what? To be obedient towards their husbands. To be obedient. We have multiple traditions that mention the word ta'a, obedience. Ta'a of who? Of the husband. The Prophet mentions it. Ahlul Bayt mention it. Salamullah alayhim. They want Muslim women to be obedient towards their husbands. Of course, this does not mean that the lady must obey her husband when her husband commands her to disobey God. I think it's quite obvious when someone commands you to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you should not obey them. Correct? Because Allah's obedience is second to none. But concerning issues that please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, concerning issues that please Allah, the more obedient a wife is towards her husband in regards of those issues, the better it will be for her and for her family. The better it will be for her and for her household. Bear in mind, there are rights that the husband has over his wife and vice versa. The husband does have authority in certain issues. And these issues are mentioned where? In the books of jurisprudence. Perhaps one day in a class or a discussion we can mention these issues in detail. But what we're saying right now is, aside from the issues in which the lady is obligated to obey her husband, the more obedience she shows, the better it will be for her, her husband, and the household as a whole. The traditions of Ahlul Bayt salamullah alayhim are very clear on this matter. For example, let me share with you one tradition with the limited time we have. In Bihar al-Anwar, Allama al-Majlisi rahmatullah alayhi cites the book Amal al-Saduq. There's a lengthy tradition by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. In it he says, فَأَيُّمَا امْرَأَةٍ صَلَّتْ فِي الْيَوْمِ وَالْلَيْلَ خَمْسَ صَلَوَاتٍ وَصَامَتْ شَهْرَ رَمَضَانٍ وحجت بيت الله الحرام وزكت مالها وأطاعت زوجها ووالت عليا بعدي دخلت الجنة بشفاعة ابنتي فاطمة. He says, any lady who performs her five daily prayers, fasts the month of Ramadan, performs pilgrimage, pays alms, obeys her husband, and believes in the authority and guardianship of Ali after me, that lady will enter heaven through the intercession of my daughter Fatima, salawatullah alayha. Now look at the narration carefully. The Prophet mentions salat. Salat is a pillar, one of the pillars of Islam. He mentions siyam, that's also a pillar. He mentions hajj, that's also a pillar. And beside those pillars, he mentions what? The obedience of the husband. Which means that's a big deal in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if we connect the narrations of Rasulullah together, what do we understand? We understand that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, men should be merciful and gentle towards their wives. Women should show obedience towards their husbands. If men do what the Prophet said and women do what the Prophet said, what will happen? You will see them living in happiness. There will be an atmosphere of what? Of forgiveness, piety, peace, love, and respect. Hence, Amirul Mu'mineen salawatullah wa salamu alayh confirmed this issue. He confirmed whatever we're just saying when he summarized his relationship with who? With the Lady of Light, Fatima salawatullah alayha. He summarized his relationship with As-Sayyida Zahra in two words. Two words. What did he say? Bear in mind, these two words are really important because Ali and Fatima salamullah alayhima, they are our role models. Their marriage was the ideal marriage. Do you imagine Amir al-Mu'mineen disputing any day with Sayyida Fatima? You don't. Do you imagine Sayyida Fatima disputing with Amir al-Mu'mineen? You don't. They never differed. They never disputed. So, what was the secret? Aside from them being infallible, alayhimu salatu wassalam, look at what Imam Ali says. He says, Wallahi ma aghdabtuha wala akrahtuha ala amrin hatta qabadaha Allahu azza wa jal. He says, I swear by Allah, I never angered her and I never forced her to do something she did not want to do until she passed away. Wa wallahi, he says, وَوَاللَّهِ وَلَا أَغْضَبَتْنِي مَا أَغْضَبَتْنِي وَلَا عَصَتْ لِي أَمْرًا. And I swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, she never angered me. وَلَا أَغْضَبَتْنِي وَلَا عَصَتْ لِي أَمْرًا. And she never disobeyed any of my commands. So Amir al-Mu'mineen showed what? Extreme mercy And Fatima showed extreme obedience. When the husband reveals extreme mercy and the wife reveals extreme obedience, what's going to happen? They will live happily ever after, as they say. There'll be an atmosphere of harmony, of peace, of love between them. Then he said, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayha, wa laqad kuntu anzuru ilayha, fatankashif anni alhumum wal ahzan. He says, when I used to look at Fatima alayha salam, when I used to gaze at Fatima salamullah alayha, my distress and my sorrow would fade away. Subhanallah. As soon as he sees the Lady of Light, he is relieved from sorrow and from distress. Yes. Her presence, alayha salatu wassalam, would make him rejoice. But my question is, what was Amir al-Mu'mineen feeling, alayhi salatu wassalam, during moments like these? And what was Rasulullah feeling during moments like these? As both of them were looking at Fatima alayha salatu wassalam, seeing Fatima in a very heartbreaking state. Zahra alayha salatu wassalam was seeing her father on the brink of martyrdom. He was poisoned and was fainting every once in a while. She knew that it was only a matter of days or hours until she loses Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. And on top of that, she also knew what was going to happen as soon as Rasulullah leaves this world. Amir al-Mu'mineen knew, Sayyidah Fatima knew. Rasulullah informed them, salawatullah alayhim, and told Amir al-Mu'mineen what he's supposed to do. Told Fatima what she's supposed to do when calamities are poured upon them. Indeed, the last moments of Rasulullah's life, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, were very disturbing, very difficult, especially on Ali, Fatima, Al-Hasan wal-Husayn, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhim. Imam Al-Kadhim alayhi salam tells us, during his last moments, Rasulullah commanded everyone who was in his room to leave. Why? He wanted to be with the four, salamullah alayhim. He summoned Ali, Fatima, Al-Hasan, wal-Husayn, salawatullah alayhim. And he told Salama to sit beside the door and not to allow anyone to enter in the room. He wanted to be with the four infallibles. And so Ali came, Fatima, Hasan, and Husayn. They all came, salamullah alayhim. The Prophet, salallahu alayhi wa alayhi, said what? He said, Ya Ali, udnu minni, Ali, come close to me. Then he took the hand of Fatima alayha salam and he placed it on his chest for a long time, the tradition says. And he took the hand of Ali with his other hand. He grabbed it. Then the Prophet wanted to speak, but he was unable to. Why? Out of his crying. He was heartbroken. He began crying. Out of his crying, he wasn't able to talk. What do you think happened to Sayyidah Fatima at that point? What happened to Ali, Al-Hasan wal-Husayn, salamullah alayhim? Sayyidah Zahra began crying bitterly. Ali, Hasan, and Husayn also cried bitterly. Sayyidah Zahra, salamullah alayha, addressed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, saying, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, لقد قطعت قلبي وأحرقت كبدي. You have shattered my heart and you have caused my soul to burn. she tells him, O master of all prophets, man li wani ba'dak, who will be there for my progeny after you, wa man li dhullin yanzilu bi ba'dak, and who will be there when I am afflicted with humiliation after you, and who will be there for Ali, your brother and the supporter of the religion, and who will be there for the revelation of Allah and His commands. Ajarakumullah. At that point, Fatima, Ali, Hassan and Hussein fell on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. They fell on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi. Fatima began kissing the face of the Prophet. At that point, Rasulullah lifted his head and took the hand of Fatima and placed it in the hand of Ali and addressed Amir al-Mu'mineen saying, Ya Aba al-Hasan, hadihi wadi'atullah wa wadi'atu Rasul Muhammad. عندك فاحفظ الله واحفظني فيها وإنك لفاعل. He told them, O Abul Hassan, this lady over here is the trust of Allah and His Messenger Muhammad. Allah and His Messenger entrust you with this lady, so take good care of her, and certainly you shall do so. Then he told them, O Ali, I swear by Allah, she is the mistress of the women of heaven. I swear by Allah, she is the greater Maryam alayhi salam. He kept on talking until he said, Ya Ali, know that I am pleased with whoever my daughter Fatima is pleased with. The same applies to my Lord and His angels alayhim as-salam. Then he said these heartbreaking words, Ajarakallah ya sahib al-zaman. He said, Ya Ali, ويلون لمن ظلمها. Oh Ali, woe unto he who shall oppress her. وويلون لمن ابتزها حقها. And woe unto he who shall usurp her right. وويلون لمن انتهك حرمتها. And woe unto he who shall violate her sanctity. وويلون لمن أحرق بابها. And woe unto you shall burn her door. وويل لمن آذى جنينها وشج جنبيها. And woe unto you shall hurt her fetus and wound her sides. وويل لمن شقها وبارزها. And woe unto he who shall openly
openly oppose her and go against her. Then he said, oh Allah, Allahumma inni minhum bari wa hum minni bura. Oh Allah, they have nothing to do with me and I have nothing to do with them. Then he named the oppressors of Fatima salawatullah wa salamuhu alayha. Ajarakum Allah. This was a heartbreaking moment before the Prophet's death sallallahu alayhi wa alim. Another heartbreaking moment that occurred before his death was that Hassan and Hussein salamullah alayhima, they rushed towards Rasulullah as he was unconscious. And so the two imams fell on Rasulullah as they were crying and screaming. Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam wanted to lift them off Rasulullah, but all of a sudden Rasulullah regained consciousness. He turned to Amir al-Mu'mineen. He said to him, Ya Ali, da'ni ashumhuma wa yashumani. Oh Ali, let me smell their fragrance and let them smell mine. وأتزود منهما ويتزودان مني. And let me spend more time with them and let them spend more time with me. For surely they shall be oppressed after me and they shall be killed oppressively. May Allah curse those who oppress them. Ah, وحسنا وحسينا ومظلوما. Ibn Abbas says, when Rasulullah was on his deathbed, Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam was on the chest of Rasulullah. Rasulullah was kissing Aba Abdullah and he was telling him, Mali وليزيد. What business does Yazid have with me? May Allah deprive him of a blessing. Oh Allah, curse Yazid. Indeed, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi was mourning his grandsons because he knew what was going to happen to them after he departs from this world. Ajarakum Allah, ajarak Allah ya sahib al-zaman. Before his death, when his death drew near, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi turned to Amir al-Mu'mineen. He told him, Ya Ali, ضَعَ رَأْسِي فِي حِجْرِكَ فَقَدْ جَاءَ أَمْرُ اللَّهِ. Oh Ali, place my head in your lap, for my death has arrived. When my soul comes out from my body, then claim it with your hand and place it, rub it on your face. He tells him, turn me towards the Qibla, make me face the Qibla, and prepare me for burial. Be the first to pray on my body and do not leave me until you bury me. أجركم الله. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi fell unconscious. Fatima alayhi salam came, seeing her father in that state, she threw herself beside Rasulullah and began gazing at his beautiful face as she laments him. She lamented him with a couplet of poetry said by Abu Talib. وَأَبْيَضُونِ يُسْتَسْقَى الْغَمَامِ آمُ بِوَجْهِهِ وَأَبْيَضُونِ يُسْتَسْقَى الْغَمَامُ بِوَجْهِهِ ثمال اليتامى عصمة للأرامل. أجركم الله. And so Rasulullah opened his eyes and said in a faint voice, he said, daughter Fatima, this is the couplet of your uncle Abu Talib. This is the saying of your uncle Abu Talib. Do not say it, rather say, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ. And Muhammad is not but a messenger. قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِي الرَّسُولِ. The messengers have come to this world and left before him. أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلْ إِنْقَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ. If he dies or gets killed, will you then turn upon, will you turn back upon your heels? At that moment, Fatima alayhi salam cried for a long time. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi told her to come near him. Fatima alayhi salam came close. Rasulullah at that point told Fatima a secret, which made Fatima alayhi salam rejoice. Allahu Akbar. What makes Fatima rejoice at that moment? She was asked after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi, what did the Prophet tell you which relieved you at that point? She said, he told me that I will be the first member amongst his household to go to him, and that the period between my death and his will not be a long period. I say, Ya Rasulullah, you were right. You were right. It was only a short time after your demise when Fatima alayhi salam also passed away. She came back to you. But in what state, Ya Rasulullah? She came back with a broken rib, with a red eye. She came back with a body that was overwhelmed with pain and a broken heart. Aywa Fatimata wa shahidata wa mazlumata ajarakumullah. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi grabbed Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam and brought him close to him. Both of them were under a cloak. Rasulullah began talking in secret with Amir al-Mu'mineen for a long time. Suddenly, Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam comes out from beneath the cloak in a gentle manner, and he addresses the Muslims saying, أعظم الله أجوركم في نبيكم. May Allah greatly reward you for the loss of your prophet. فَقَدْ قَبَضَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِ. For Allah has taken him to the hereafter. رَحِمَ اللَّهَ مَنْ صَاحَوَى مُحَمَّدًا. أيوا نبي الله ومسموما أجركم الله. فعندها انقلبت المدينة بأهلها ما بين باك وباكيا. صاح المسلمون وصاحت مولاتنا الزهراء ودخل عليها من الحزن ما لا يعلم مبلغه إلا الله سبحانه وتعالى. حر قلبي لفاطمة وهي ترى أباها مسجى وتراه على المغتسل وكأني بها اتخاطبة. تقل اسم الله على طولك يا جمال الهاشمية. عالمغتسل عالمغتسل ممدود يا خير البرية. وين معي وانا فاطمية على رسول الله تقل اسم الله على طولك يا جماعة علي الهاشمية عالمغتسل ممدود يا خير البرية يا المرتضى اكشف لي عن الوالي وجماله شيل الكفن عن غرته اتودعه شماله هذا الحسن مشعوب قلب انظر الحاله وهذا الشهيد حسين عبراته جريئه بعد كأني بها اتخاطب الذين يهيلون التراب على النبي يلي تهيلون الثرى دفنوني وياه ما اقدر اشوف البيت خالي من محيا كشرة تراه تصير عيشتنا بلايا بعد النبي مريد هالدنيا الدنيا ومحمده ومصيبته وأهل بيت محمد أختم لك بهذا الكلام أقول يا رسول الله عزت مصيبتك على أهل البيت عليهم السلام ولكن الذي يزيدنا ألما أن مصيبتك يا رسول الله فتحت أبواب المصائب على أهل بيتك يا رسول الله قم وانظر إلى ابنتك فاطمة ساعات أو أيام بعد وفاتك تعصر بين الحائط والباب وهي تنادي أبتاه يا رسول الله أهكذا كان يصنع بحبيبتك يا رسول الله قم وانظر إلى وصيك علي في محرابه يضربه ابن ملجم على رأسه فيطيح في المحراب مخطبا بدمائه يا رسول الله قم وانظر إلى ابنك الحسن قد مال لونه إلى الخضرة وهو يقذف كبده قطعة قطعة من سم معاوية يا رسول الله قم وانظر إلى ابنك الحسين في كربلاء انظر إلى رأس الحسين على رمح طويل وانظر إلى جسد الحسين تحت سنابك الخيل وانظر إلى ابنتك زينب مقيدة على الناقة بلا ناصر ولا معين
يا رسول الله لو عاينتهم وهموما بين قتل وسبا لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم توجهوا إلى الله تعالى اللهم إنا نسألك وندعوك بأحب الخلق إليك محمد وعلي وفاطمة والحسن والحسين والتسعة المعصومين من ذرية الحسين فرج عنا يا الله اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج، سهل له المخرج، أوسع له المنهج، اجعلنا من جنوده وأنصاره وأوانه والمستشهدين بين يديه. اللهم ارحمنا رحمة لا تعذبنا بعدها أبدا، واغفر لنا ذنوبنا واستر عيوبنا واقضي حوائجنا. من كانت له حاجة إلى الله فليسألها فإنها تقضى. اللهم بحق نبي الرحمة وإمام الهدى صلى الله عليه وآله اقضي حاجة كل محتاج، لا سيما حوائج الحاضرين والمشاهدين ومن سألني الدعاء يا رب العالمين. اللهم اشفي وعافي جميع المرضى بحق مريض كربلاء زين العابدين عليه السلام. اللهم ارحم أمواتنا وأموات المؤمنين والمؤمنات، لا سيما المنسين الذين لا يذكرهم ذاكر، والشهداء العظام والعلماء الكرام، إلى أرواحهم جميعا وإلى أرواح أمواتكم وأمواتي وإلى أرواح والدي وأخي وحبيبي حسين. نبعث ثواب مجلسنا هذا وثواب الفاتحة تسبقها صلاة على محمد وآل محمد.